Hi, I'm Mike Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer. Republicans in Florida, they're trying to out-crazy one another with their legislative proposal, and we'll tell you about two pieces of legislation that's going to send shivers down your spine. The government's getting closer to banning popular social media app TikTok over concerns that China could be using it to spy on Americans. And cereal companies, well, they've unleashed an army of lobbyists to Washington, D.C. to convince the FDA that they should be able to lie to consumers. That's what they're asking to do. All that and more, it's all coming up right here on America's Lawyer. Don't go anywhere. A proposed bill in the state of Florida would require any blogger who writes about the Florida government to register with the state, which is a clear violation of the First Amendment, but that doesn't mean anything to this yucklehead right here. This is, why don't you pick up with Mr. Broder, who, I don't know, maybe he never took civics, maybe he's never read a book, but he comes up with this idea that if you are a blogger and you criticize the governor, or you criticize the cabinet, or you talk about some bad thing happened in Florida politics, that by golly, you need to register. And you need to tell every time you tell the story, tell them about the story you told. This is crazy. I can't even say it. It's this goofball, Broder, really believes that this is possible in America in 2023. Hell, maybe it is. What do you think?
Well, anything is possible, unfortunately. And that's the really terrifying part about this, because 2 years ago, we would look at a story like this. It's not even going to make it to the floor for a vote. But now, with everything we've seen, who knows? I mean, this could be the next big challenge at the Supreme Court, but this legislation that Mr. Broder here put forward late last week basically says, listen, if you're a blogger, which they don't even clearly define blogger.
It's so vague.
But it certainly applies to anyone.
Are we bloggers because we do a show?
I think technically we would fall under that category.
Right.
Because
can I announce right now? We're going to be your first test case because we're not going to do a damn thing that passes in this legislation. We're going to test the case. Go ahead and pass it. Let's see how you do with it. Go ahead.
Yeah. So what you would have to do, you know, what we would be legally required to do is every month on the 10th of the month, we would have to submit a report, each and every one of us, listing the title of the story we did, when it was published, where it was published, and how much we were paid to write that story or to do that video.
Like somebody pays us.
Right. Yeah. Which would include, you know, any YouTube revenue, Facebook revenue. Because what they want to do is try to say that bloggers, and he actually said this in an interview, bloggers are basically lobbyists who lobby with their words.
Okay, so I see this goofy stare on this guy right here. I can see him saying, yeah, this is a good idea.
Well, it's gotten so bad that even Newt Gingrich, you know, Mr. Contract with America, came out over the weekend and had to say, listen, this is his word, insane.
Yeah.
What these Republicans are doing in the state of Florida has gotten so bad that, you know, the old guard, Newt Gingrich, has come out and said, you guys are insane. What is happening here is not normal. You can't do this.
We expect this from Trump.
Yeah.
Okay? It's nutcrackery, man.
Yeah.
All right, governments across the world are banning the popular social media app TikTok because they believe China is using it to spy on them. You know, the United States last week got one step closer to giving President Biden the power to end the app in this country. Okay, this is way crazy in and of itself. Now, first of all, I really do believe that they're doing a lot of bad things with the app. I do believe they're spying on us.
Yeah.
You know, there's a thousand things that scare me about TikTok. But to say we're going to pass legislation that lets the President of the United States unilaterally decide, I'm going to ban it. Okay, now we're already banning TikTok in U.S. government offices, right?
Yeah.
Pick it up from there.
Yeah, this is terrifying. And it's moving forward at lightning pace right now. You've got Democrats and Republicans joining forces to say Biden needs to have the authority to be able to do this. Or maybe, you know, the other reports say maybe we'll give the power to the Secretary of State. But either way, this opens the door for the next administration, whoever that may be, and it could be a very terrifying one, to say, oh, okay, well, we've got this power. I don't like Facebook. I'm going to ban Facebook.
Yeah.
I don't like Yelp. Let's get rid of Yelp because they're using location services.
You are putting unchecked unilateral power in the hands of the president or whoever it is at the time to say, I don't like this, we're going to get rid of it. But don't you see the real problem here? This is such an unsophisticated approach to the problem.
Yeah.
First of all, I believe they're stealing our data all over the country. They're ripping stuff off from us left and right. Scientific data, military data, personal data, health data. I think the Chinese are just loading that up through TikTok. You know, there's pretty good data to show that's happening.
Yeah.
I get that. But there's other ways to deal with this besides this legislation that says, hey, we're going to create a new, a new guy in charge. If he doesn't like what you're doing, he's going to end it.
Well, and, you know, why would they think that TikTok is the only method that this is taking place? It's happening on Twitter. It's happening on Facebook. It's happening, you know, through Google. All of these social media outlets, if they were to ban TikTok, by the end of the week, we're going to have 20 apps that do the exact same thing right here available. That's the way this works.
Yeah.
So to target this one specific one just because it is, you know, based out of China, it shows that we're operating not out of a genuine concern for our privacy data. We're doing it out of the xenophobic.
What's the difference? Okay, remember all the crazy MSNBC, Russia's coming. Why is the media not reacting the same here, the same in this situation, when we know that it's going on? Look, I don't mind there being some regulation across the board. You can't, there's equal protection argument. You can't center on them. You got to do it across the board. Second of all, the idea of we're going to put it in one person's hands to make that decision is crazy. It's ludicrous. It's like they've never taken a civics class when they wrote this. But I will tell you this. You know, first of all, I'm kind of torn on this story because I think a lot of what's being said about what's happening through TikTok is absolutely true. It's not guesswork anymore. They have pretty good proof of it.
Right.
But here's what China says. I love this quote. It says, a U.S. ban on TikTok is a ban on our ability to export American culture and values to billion-plus people and to use our World Wide Web to tell the world about American culture. That's the Chinese answer to what's going on here. You buy that?
No, it's their way of sucking up. Like, but wait a minute, if you ban us, we can't tell everybody how awesome America is, and don't you want that?
How will they ever know about Honey Boo Boo, huh? You know, they'll miss all the opportunity to understand Honey Boo Boo quality social media. Crazy story. Can you believe it? After a public pressure campaign that's now spanned years, Eli Lilly has announced that they're going to cap the price of insulin to just $35 a month. A major win for consumers? Not hardly. This is the worst PR scam I've ever seen. Let me begin with saying this. It costs $7 a vial. $7 a vial to create this insulin, right? Now, they were trying to sell it for, the numbers are staggering, almost $250 per vial. Pick it up from there.
Yeah, this is 100% a PR stunt. It is not even really a win for consumers because technically they didn't change their policy. It was always $35 per month. The way they figure this out is they do these incentives and the rebates when you go through insurance. So even though you see the sticker shock of, you know, $200 for the regular Eli Lilly insulin, you were not paying that. What you're paying for, of course, are the more expensive additives because sometimes the insurance won't cover the original one. So this is all a big smoke and mirrors type thing. Eli Lilly always had this policy. They're just trying to get the public, they're trying to get Bernie Sanders off their back.
Okay, let's talk about insulin just a little bit. This is a product that has been around for almost a century, okay? The people who developed the product gave it to a university in Toronto and said, just use it, it's not ours, it's free. You take it, you help people with it. The truth is, then you had Eli Lilly, Sanofi, Nordisk, all of these awful people that run the pharmaceutical money-making process says, hey, well, we're going to buy it, and we're going to make it so expensive that at some point people are having to cut down on the amount of use. They're actually cutting their use in half just so they can make it. Bernie Sanders comes out. He says, You got some splaining to do. As soon as they do that, they come in here with their lies. Their lies are this. This is expensive because of R&D. We've had research and development. There's been zero research and development. It's been around for a century. There's been no scientific advancements at all. It's the same product that character gave away almost a century ago. And now all they're doing is raping American consumers who are sick with diabetes, and we're not doing a damn thing about it.
Yeah, and this is kind of like the Moderna story we talked about a couple weeks ago. Bernie Sanders threatens the CEO to explain why you're jacking up the price of the COVID vaccine. Then finally, Moderna's like, okay, we're not going to do it. Bernie Sanders puts all this pressure. I mean, back in his 2020 campaign, he traveled across the border to Canada with a group of diabetics to witness them firsthand having to buy insulin in bulk in Canada because they couldn't afford it here in the U.S. Okay. So he has been at the forefront of this for many, many years. He put the pressure on them, and he's smart enough to know this is smoke and mirrors. So okay. I don't think he's
They've
done
They've been either. Sued, and here's what the suit says. That they're saying, Mr. and Ms. Lilly, you met with the other manufacturers. You talked about and discussed what they were charging. You came up with a price-fixing scheme. You sold that price-fixing scheme to government. You did it in a way that you increased the cost of your product from $25 to $275 over this period of time. It's price-fixing. It's antitrust. They're going to get sued. And you know what? I'm going to have the opportunity to take the depositions. Interesting. Just happens to be. I will be taking those depositions, and I promise they will be a bloodbath because there's no defense to what these folks are doing. And the very fact that they're making this look like they really care about us, that they're trying to really give us a break, is nonsense.
Right. And as you pointed out, it only costs $7 to make a vial of insulin. They would turn a huge profit if they turned around and sold it for $9,
right,
is what
right,
the reports
right.
tell
Well,
us.
That was how it started out.
Yeah.
Started out, well, we're going to charge a reasonable amount because people will die. You know, they'll die without their insulin. And people are having to use half amounts, just cut their amount in half, which is extremely dangerous.
I mean, we're talking about, 7 million people in this country that are on insulin daily.
Yes.
If they only paid a $2 markup on these vials, you're talking about $14 million for every vial these people made.
Pigs at the trough. That's what's working here. Mr. and Ms. Lilly, Eli Lilly, pigs at the trough. That's what you are right now, and you know it. Okay, so American politicians want you to think that the threat of China spying on you through TikTok is a serious danger. But at the same time, they're trying to renew their FISA powers so that our own government can spy on you more easily. Talk about this story. You have followed this from the very beginning. I'm going to hush. You do this story. I tell you what, this is amazing to me.
Yeah, this is absolutely one of the biggest cases of hypocrisy we've ever seen. Obviously, you know, following 9/11, we had the sweeping changes to our FISA law here in the United States to where our intelligence agencies can go and do this bulk gathering, phone calls, text messages, emails, you know, computer data, without a warrant. Mm-hmm. And it expires every couple years. Congress has to renew it. And each time it comes up for renewal, you hear the same arguments from the civil liberties groups, a couple of certain senators, Ron Wyden is one of them, who say, listen, you're using this to spy on Americans. You can make all the arguments you want that, oh, but we caught, you know, 3 terrorists in the last 5 years using this. You're gathering up data of millions of Americans. This is the same thing Snowden told us about. This is a bad program, and you're spying on
us. Yeah, I mean, this has been around. Here's the bad news. They don't care. Yeah. The American public doesn't care if they're spied on anymore. I don't know. It's like a cultural change that took place, you know, in this country. Assange, they think Assange is some kind of awful guy because he discloses the amount of spying that the U.S. government's doing. Snowden, they try, oh, he sent him to Russia. Who the hell cares? He was disclosing the amount of spying that goes on. But if what people don't get is all the numbers show, I mean, across the board, the American public has been so desensitized to this, they don't care if they're spied on. I mean, that's a simple truth.
Well, right. And the telecom companies, of course, push this big time. They send their lobbyists to D.C. to start taking everybody out to fancy dinners and golf resorts because they want this to still happen because they get huge money from the federal government to turn over this data. Again, no warrants. You don't have to go to a judge. Here's your data. Give me all this money.
It's worse than FISA. The other day, I was working on the lead to Crossroads, Clapton's Crossroads. I'm just sitting in there playing. I use the, you know, I've got, I guess I had my phone there. Maybe I got the computer turned on, and I'm working on Crossroads. Well, okay, I close everything up, set my guitar down, turn on Pandora. You know the first song that comes up? Crossroads. Now, tell me there's not something, I mean, is that, what are the chances of that kind of coincidence? And so it's not just FISA. It's we're being spied on it in every kind of way, and we don't care anymore. Maybe you care. I do care. But most people don't care.
Right. We've sat here. We've done stories, you know, recently about your Roomba, your vacuum that is now owned by Amazon, by the way. It's sending the data about what's in your home back to these massive corporations who, of course, can then turn it over to the federal government without a warrant, thanks to FISA. It's all connected, and people don't understand
Some
that.
Some people are so comfortable that they have, what is the Amazon, what's that thing?
Alexa.
Alexa. Okay, Alexa runs everything about their house. It turns on their lights. It turns on the television. It's all over their house. And they're getting the same kind of thing I just described about that happened to me. But I just, it's so amazing to me that people really don't seem to care anymore.
No, they don't. And it's all that post 9/11 mentality. I've got to be safe. And I guess I can give up all my civil liberties to do that.
Yeah, yeah. You know, all that sugary cereal that millions of Americans eat every day? Well, it's not exactly healthy. But thanks to a loophole in FDA regulations, they can still be labeled as really healthy. Good for consumers, good for your children, good for your health. And now the FDA wants to change that. Some of the biggest cereal makers are spending millions of dollars to make sure that they can call it healthy. Pick it up.
This is a truly bizarre story because it's not something people would typically think about, like, what do we care about cereal? Well, we're lying to consumers is what these cereal companies want to continue to do. They're going to the FDA. They're spending millions on lobbyists to tell them, we've got to be able to lie because if we can't slap that healthy label on, I mean, look how brightly colored the sugar is, then we can't sell it. And we're talking about cereals that typically studies have shown children do, you know, double the serving size, which means they're getting as much sugar for breakfast. It's the equivalent of eating just a Snickers bar for breakfast.
Okay, so here's their argument. Well, first of all, the craziest argument is, you know what? Constitutionally, we have a right to lie. We can lie to consumers. It's our constitutional right to lie to consumers. Yes, we are lying to consumers, and it's okay, and you can't change that. That's the first argument. The second argument is, you know what? We're really doing this for the American public because poverty-stricken people, they want to make it more affordable and accessible for people who can't afford a lot. So give this to the kids, let them fill up on sugar, send them off to school, and everything's going to be okay. Some of it falls on the parents, right? I mean, some of this really does fall on the parent. A parent reads this, Fruity Pebbles, I mean, Lucky Charms, don't you say, well, there, you know, probably some sugar here. Don't you at least check that out? But the problem is they're selling it as a healthy, safe product for your children.
Yeah, and look, there's some vitamins in there. You know, they do pack it in there, but it's the sugar that, of course, is the problem. I mean, diabetes is an epidemic here in the United States, and these cereals sure as heck aren't helping that. And to argue that, you know, as a, you know, producer, you have the right to lie, that's no different than a car manufacturer saying, listen, there's a good chance this car could fly. I mean, maybe you want to buy it because it could fly.
And constitutionally, we can lie to you.
Right.
So try to fly it. And if it doesn't work, we're still okay.
You just got to go really fast off that cliff. It'll fly for a little bit.
Yeah.
But that's where we're at. And these, unfortunately, these manufacturers, you're talking about Post, General Mills, Kellogg's, they've got a good chance at being successful here because they've successfully avoided this loophole closing.
The real ugly part of this are the freaks that are doing this for them.
Yeah.
Talk about, it's this really shady kind of PR group. They were the same people that argued on behalf of the OxyContin industry, saying, oh, this is, you don't have any problems with this. This is not going to be something that's addictive. These are the same people that the cereal industry, they take them, okay, The Oxy experience killed 150 people a day for, what, two decades? Now, let's talk about this, because we want to make your little seven-year-old Freddie into a sumo wrestler. We don't care if he's morbidly fat. We don't care if he gets diabetes, because it's our right to lie if we want to lie.
Yeah, this group is called the Washington Legal Foundation, which sounds like a very, legal foundation. Of course they're good.
Yeah.
Now, what it is really just a lobbyist organization. Like you said, they fought on behalf of the opioid manufacturers. They've done all kinds of things with the corn refiners, sugar, pills.
Yeah.
That is what this group does to make sure we keep those on our streets.
But don't you see the connection here? How it's almost dark humor. This creepy Washington organization works in the dark. They worked in the dark on OxyContin, knowing that that 150 people a day were dying from OxyContin. Now, let's move over to little seven-year-old fat Freddie, who's eating two bowls of this every morning and then off to school, and he ends up with diabetes, he ends up morbidly fat. And what are you going to do about that? It's our right to do it. We have a right to do that.
Yeah, it's truly disgusting, even just from the humanitarian aspect of it. You know, you like to talk about all the time. These people go home from work and they sit down and the kids are, how was your day at work? Oh, it's great. I fought to make sure that poor people become morbidly obese and end up with health problems.
Yeah, you know what you're talking about, the people that work for this organization.
Yeah.
That's your good day, right? I had a success today. We're going to have more little fat Freddies around, seven-year-old sumo wrestlers. We're going to create a whole generation of them, because we're going to sell Lucky Charms and Fruity Pebbles. And you know what? We're going to argue we have a constitutional right to lie to the American public to do it. That's that story, isn't it?
It is.
The Democratic Party could become illegal in the state of Florida if a Republican lawmaker has his way. A state representative has introduced legislation banning the Democratic Party and forcibly switching voter registration of any registered Democrat. Wow! Isn't this another question of, where the hell is the Florida governor DeSantis? What the story we just did was, what, Meatball Head that they're starting to call him?
Yeah.
He's starting to look like Meatball Head. Why would you allow this to happen? Why wouldn't the governor show up in Tallahassee and say, what the hell? What are y'all trying to do? First of all, you got a blogger story where you're trying to register bloggers. If they talk about government, they talk bad about government, you're going to fine them. Now this story where we're going to try to do away with the Democratic Party based on the fact that the Democrats, and it is true, had a long history of supporting slavery.
Right.
I mean, they were the party of slavery leading up to the Civil War and even after the Civil War.
Yeah, right. And that's the thing is, you know, nobody disputes that. We all understand that. There was a big realignment of the political parties in the early 20th century, then again after the Civil Rights Movement, and that's when the Democrats moved into, we're not the party of racism anymore, and Republicans, Southern Strategy, we know the rest. There was a difference in the parties, but Republicans always want to go back to that whole Civil War thing of, well, you guys supported slavery. Look, if you got to go back 160 years to attack the party, then you don't have an argument.
Yeah.
But this would, I mean, what he says in the bill, Blaise Ignalia is the guy. He says, if your party has a history, if you've ever supported slavery, you are hereby banned from having this party in the state of Florida.
Yeah.
So all of your voter registrations, as soon as this bill gets signed, immediately switch to no party affiliation or independent. You can have that choice. But this would mean no Democratic primaries in the state of Florida, nobody allowed on a ballot with a D next to their name, which would include presidential elections.
Yeah.
This is election rigging, and it's voter disenfranchisement, but more importantly, this is scary as hell. This is Nazi stuff.
I wish in this picture they got my hometowns, Arcadia, Florida, and Port Charlotte, and Okeechobee, Sarasota. It's all of Florida. Here's what happened in Florida, okay? Charlie Crist was a terrible candidate to run under the Democratic ticket. It was a rout. By the way, where is Charlie now? I mean, somebody send in a comment. If you've seen Charlie, please let us know. Okay, so this rout takes place. It gives this governor, DeSantis, the idea that he can do anything he wants to do, and he tells legislators, you know, go have some fun with this. And this is, it makes him look like meatheads. It does make them look like meatheads to even come up with such a thing.
It really does. And what's funny is, you know, this story and the first story we talked about with the bloggers, this all happened within the same four-day span down here in the state of Florida. Yeah. During that time, Ron DeSantis was traveling the country, giving speeches in different states for his presidential run that he's hasn't announced, but we all see it. But so he left, and then he comes home and realizes the kids have just been throwing a big-ass party all week.
Like Home Alone, man. Macaulay kid. You know.
Except the problem is he's not looking at it as a problem. He's back. He's like, let's keep it going.
Okay, now here, DeSantis can win. I mean,
that's scary.
There's very scary thought. He can win. If you load up with Haley and some of these other lesser Republicans, splits the ticket, that's his best shot. Yeah. That's the best shot for Trump. But the point is this, unless something weird happens like that, DeSantis can win. He will beat the hell out of Newsom from California. It's going to be Florida versus California. It's going to be middle America, right in the middle of all that. And it's going to be the difference because he's appealing to middle America. But the point is, to me, if you're serious about becoming president of the United States, why don't you walk into the House there, walk into the legislature and say, have you guys lost your frigging mind? Would you please stop acting like children? I don't know why he's not making a decision to do that.
I think it's because he's good with everything that's happening, and that's, of course, what makes it more terrifying. And like you said, he won his reelection by the biggest margin we have seen in decades here in the state of Florida. Even in presidential elections, we haven't seen a landslide like that.
But he's giving that up, don't you see? He's giving that up by letting these fools in Tallahassee come up with idiotic ideas like this, or the blogger scheme, where if you're a blogger and you talk bad about the governor, you can be fined. I mean, really? Don't you just say, hey, kids, go home. I got it from here. I don't know. Farron, thanks for joining me.
Thank you.
For more than 100 years, institutions have been popping up in America, promising to put troubled teens in the right track. But all too soon, these teens end up being subjected to what can only be described as torture in these institutions. Join me to talk about that and what's happening is Caleb Cunningham. Caleb, let me ask you right off the bat. People don't even know about this. They hear, well, so-and-so was sent to a reformatory of some kind. They have all kinds of words for it. Why don't you lay this story out for me a little bit?
So essentially, this stuff has existed for more than 100 years. I know you did a great show on the Dozier School, and that's not a one-off. You know, you've got 80 dead children in unmarked graves in Dozier here in Florida, and that's happening around the country. These children are being subjected to unimaginable cruelty under the guise of wilderness therapy, of conversion camps, of reformatory schools. They've got a lot of different names, but what they're selling is this miraculous snake oil, that something is wrong with your child and we can fix them.
Yeah.
We can fix them.
Send them away. Right. Just give complete control to us and we're going to fix them. Just like you mentioned, Dozier, there's graves everywhere where we don't even know where the children are buried.
Right.
Where they were beat, they were raped, they were murdered, and they were put in graves in that Dozier area, right there in Marianna, Florida. But people don't understand, this is an industry, okay? This is not just one-off. This is an industry. Talk about the industry of this whole idea of you know, troubled, exploited teen industry.
And it's big money in it. You know, there's about $23 billion of public funds going to this because it's not just parents who are being lied to. It's juvenile judges, psychiatric professionals, things like that, that are being lied to by these people. And it's big business. It's for-profit companies running private prisons for children, these hell holes. Again, I apologize for the foul language, but that's what these are. Mm-hmm. These are terrors that we are allowing to happen in this country, and they're profiting off of it.
Well, okay, let's back up on the idea. It started out where, you know, maybe a Catholic church would say, we have a place you can send a troubled teen. We're going to work with them. That was a disaster. Right. More abuse cases. The Mormon church did the same thing. Anytime you see that lining up, it's usually bad. It has a bad ending to it. But this is even worse because you've got Wall Street.
Right.
Wall Street saying, hey, we can make a lot of money with these troubled kids. It doesn't make any difference what we do to them because nobody ever finds out.
basically they've gotten away with a lot for a long time, haven't they?
They absolutely have. And well, and like we saw with the abuses with the Catholic Church or the Boy Scouts of America, these kids, they have a built-in excuse and say, oh, they're troubled. Oh, you can't believe what they say. And so when the abusers get caught, they blame the victim, as we see time and time again. And it's the same abuses, but it's systematic and it's disgusting because you have a culmination of no regulation or little regulation, money, and children. So predators are attracted to this, negligent people are attracted to this, and like you said, Wall Street money is backing a lot of this because they see big money.
And that's important because regulators are nullified. There's not the regulators, if you just look at Dozier, there were no regulators. No. If you look at this the school up in Philadelphia where the judges were getting paid, they're getting kickbacks to send these kids to this reform school. They called it, I don't know what they referred to it, but it's reform school. So they caught these two judges, both of them in prison right now. But that kind of stuff goes on all over this country. And the problem is the media pays little attention to it until something terrible happens. But tell us about the give us the name of the corporations. What are the corporations that are involved in this?
So I want to talk about one specifically. Yeah. They used to be called Sequel, then they changed their name to Vivint, and now they call themselves Brighter Path.
Right? Why do they keep changing the name?
Because they keep getting in trouble.
Yeah.
We keep finding out about it. News reporters bring it to the public's attention, and so they change their name. And there's no regulation to stop them from doing this, so they rebrand. They rebrand, and they're really good at that. One of their most recent and most egregious offenses, to your point, was a 16-year-old kid in Michigan named Cornelius Fredericks. He threw a sandwich in the lunchroom. Seven adults crushed him to death for throwing that sandwich. He laid on the floor for 12 minutes, his dead body, while the nurse looked at him before they called for emergency personnel. Mm-hmm. He died. They crushed that child to death for throwing a sandwich.
Okay, that's one example, but you're handling these cases,
yes,
all over the country. And the stories that we're hearing are the same stories. It's usually the same offender because the hiring practices of these places, you know, they put a mirror under their nose. If there's condensation, yeah, you got the job. The psychiatrist and the psychologist that are keeping them there, they're a target. I just want to, you know, public know, that's a target for us. We're going after these schools, and I'm wondering, what can people do? What if you're in a community and you've heard rumors, what should people be doing about all this right now?
Well, the old adage is true. If you see something, say something. Don't let your loved ones get tricked into this, because there is an entire marketing program designed to lie to you, to cheat you. They give other parents discounts on tuition if they write these fake referrals and testimonials. And Congress has known about that. They did a report in 2008 about these kids that have been dying, the kids that have been hurt, the kids that have been sexually assaulted, and they didn't do anything.
Mm-hmm.
The only
mm-hmm.
thing that has changed since 2008 is they're more profitable than ever. They're more profitable than ever.
Well, is it the equivalent of the private prison system?
Exactly.
This is a knockoff on that. Only we're going to imprison kids, and we have a better chance at abusing them because what they do. And here's what everybody's missing: if you're a family member and this has happened to you, who's your target? How about the people who decided to put him there? The child there, the people who are the psychiatrist or psychologist who's supposed to be helping them, instead they're having a complete opposite effect. We've got cases where kids are committing suicide because the harm is so bad and they don't feel like they can ever get out of the problem, right?
Exactly. And this company is bragging about Sequel in particular in 2017 in public filings, bragged about that they estimated their value at $423 million. Mm-hmm. They were in 19 states. They had over 9,000 children in that one company's programs because it is a
private. Has anybody prosecuted them? I mean, have they been criminally prosecuted? Because these stories are story after story. And we hear it because they're calling us now.
Right.
People that, you know, we did a little bit of a story on this, and people are calling now, and the stories, you know, they're remarkable. The question is, how did that happen? And the answer always is, we didn't know. The parents, we didn't know. They covered up. The shrink there on campus was telling us that it's our child's fault.
Right.
The law enforcement are saying it's the child's fault when they turn up beat up or put in solitary confinement. This is a terrible story. I hope you'll really, really go after these people as hard as you can, Caleb, okay?
We're going to dedicate all our resources to it,
yeah.
And we're going to bring them to justice and hopefully bring some peace to these children and their families.
Yeah, thanks a lot. Thanks for joining me,
Thank
okay?
You.
That's all for this week, but all these segments are going to be available this coming week right here on this channel, and you can follow us on Twitter at America's Lawyer. I'm Mike Papantonio, and this has been America's Lawyer. We tell you the stories every week that corporate media won't tell you because their advertisers won't let them tell those stories, or their political connections are so tribal that they don't allow for it. We'll see you next time.